raise your hand if you would like God to give you a card for missions. Okay. One way we're going to do this, as Pastor mentioned, the month of November is going to be a really, really neat experience for all of us to, you know, really get in touch with our actual missionaries that we support. And one of the ways we're going to do this is we're going to sponsor tables. And we're going to ask that our members, family members, our teens, a group of teens, group of families, adult Bible study classes, children's church, whoever, what we'd like to do is host or sponsor one of our missionary families by setting up a table. If you can imagine, we'll have tables set up throughout the church, and kind of like a missionary table that you typically see. We'll have information, flyers, missionary cards, prayer letters, information about the country, about the actual mission that they support, the food, the culture. And then what we'll do is we'll just share these tables with each of us, you know, during this month, and then just to really, you know, get engaged and learn more about the missionaries. Each table will have an opportunity to have like a collection basket so we can, at the church, individuals, you know, write letters to the missionaries. We can mail those off afterwards. Just a really nice opportunity to, you know, really connect with our missionaries and share with each other within the church. So with that being said, there's a sign-up list already. We've got about 29 missionaries, so 29 tables that we'd like to set up and share. And this is a quick raise of hands. Who do you think you might be interested in participating in this event? Okay, so the sign-up is there already. We'd like to have the table set up, ideally, by the 1st of November. So this will give you a couple weeks to, you know, plan and prepare the tables. And if you sign up, we'll have contact information. We'll reach out to you and kind of help you, you know, build these tables so you can contact and some material that will be needed. So thank you very much.
Brother Ron, I'm sure there's confusion about exactly what all that entails and all that means. So they can talk to you after church in the foyer. Would that be okay? Very good. Thank you, brother. Appreciate that so very much. Well, on with the morning this morning. Kent York family has been used of God in special ways, and the Lord's had his hand upon their family. I mean, their sons, their daughter, and it's just been a wonderful journey to watch what God has done and doing with them and still doing with them. And so we're excited. And we've got good news because his family moved up to the state of Ohio primarily, and so they're going to eventually move up, sell and move up, get out of Oklahoma. That would be wonderful. That would be great if we can have them closer in our state. But Julie's going to sing and Brother Ken is going to preach, and I think we got that in the right order. I think she needs to do the singing because I've heard Brother Ken sing, so she is a gal that needs to be considered singing. But put your hands together. I want you to welcome the York family with us.
Preacher! I'm going to say hi first.
Say hi.
Then let her say.
That'll be great, brother.
Well, good morning, Hillsboro Bible Baptist. You glad to be here? Say amen.
Amen.
Now look over to the person next to you and say, my, you're good looking.
Man, you're good looking.
We were here 26 months ago, and hard to believe it's been 2 years and 2 months. And I was just so thrilled that Brother Lamb could squeeze me into his fishing and hunting schedule, because he wasn't here the last time I was here, and I think about 40 of you men were all up north somewhere fishing, and there are a few blessings out of COVID, all right, and I first heard about the COVID back in February. I was in Ohio, and I had my rent-a-car, and the radio was on, and they said, hey, don't worry about COVID-19 unless you're in 4 groups. And I thought, boy, I wonder what that is. And so I turned the radio up, and they said, first off, are you over 60 years old? And I thought, huh? Well, I'm 61. What's the second one? They said, have you ever had any heart trouble? Well, I had a heart attack 4 years ago. What's the third one? They said, are you diabetic? Well, I'm a diabetic. And I thought, surely I'll get one. And the fourth one was, are you obese? Give me a break! I clicked all 4 boxes. But praise God, I didn't get COVID during this whole thing. Until the day before yesterday. But anyway, please come back and shake my hand. But anyway, But anyway, God has sustained us during this, and I'm just so glad the church is open and we can come. Me and Julie, we lost 39 speaking engagements during the COVID outbreak. And you say, well, was that hard on you? Oh, yeah, it was. And it was tough when we had to have all those meetings canceled. And but you know what? God took care of us through it all. And it's so good to be at a church that I know I'm sure you're missing some folks today that are being careful, and that's fine, but it's just good to be in a place that's having church this morning. And thank you, Hillsborough, for having us in. And I don't know if you know it or not. If you don't, let me tell you, do you know that you've got a treasure of God in Danny and Shiggy Lamb? Do you know that? Do you know that? With the whole staff here, Matt and Stacy and is it Stacy? Shelly, Stacy, Sherry, it's one of those. Stacy, I'm sorry. But anyway, you have a treasure here at this church, and I hope you take advantage of it while it's here, because the day will come when it won't be here. And we love Brother Lamb and Shiggy, and we're just honored to be here. I started a church 40 years ago in Kalamazoo, Michigan, and I was able to lead a scoundrel of a man to the Lord. I'll never forget the Sunday he came to the altar, and I took my Bible, and I went down with him and led him to the Lord. And he passed away last week, and they had his funeral Monday of this week. And, you know, I got to thinking how much better off he is right now than battling that cancer that he had. But you know what? Each one of us, we're all beggars, aren't we? We're just beggars on this earth. And the day is coming when we're going to step into heaven. And maybe you've lost a loved one recently, or maybe you've even lost someone because of the COVID-19. As soon as that Christian steps into heaven, that's going to be a wonderful. And so Jew is going to sing this morning a beautiful song. Listen to it. It's entitled, He Welcomes the Beggar.
Amen.
At the gate, begging the rich man for bread, sores on his skin, some said he's better off dead. But when the day came, the lash closed his eyes, carried by angels to Abraham's side. And oh, what a moment when everything changes. Imagine the glory, the sound of a praise, God in his riches, lavished his treasure, and there. Welcomes a beggar. To all who are poor, bruised and broken like me, there is a home for the desperate, the lonely, the weak. Yes, there's a day coming, I'm telling you now, we'll trade all our sorrows for a glorious crown. And oh, what a moment when everything changes. Imagine the glory, the sound of
Get your Bibles out this morning. Let's go to the book of Luke, chapter number 12. Luke 12. We're going to begin reading in verse 16 this morning. Luke 12, 16. As soon as you find your place in God's Word, let's stand and we'll honor the Bible as we read it by standing. Luke chapter 12, verse number 16. Verse 16 says, "And he spake a parable unto them." Now the he here, of course, is the Lord Jesus Christ. A parable is an earthly story, but it most definitely has a heavenly meaning. You need to realize Jesus was a storyteller. I had a preacher the other day, Brother Lamb, I think he was trying to hurt my feelings. He said, "Brother Kent, you're a skyscraper preacher." I said, "Well, thank you. What does that mean?" He said, "You're story on top of story on top of story." He's trying to hurt my feelings. But I didn't take offense at that, because Jesus knew he had to use earthly stories to get people to understand the deeper truths of the things of heaven and God. And he's going to give us one of his greatest parables this morning. Look at verse 16. "The ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully, and he thought within himself, saying, 'What shall I do? Because I have no room where to bestow my fruits.' And he said, 'This will I do. I will pull down my barns and build greater, and there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul," soul? Kind of weird, isn't it? "'Thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said unto him, 'Thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then who shall those things be which thou hast provided? So is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God.'" Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. I pray right now that you would take it and begin to apply it to hearts. Lord, there's somebody here today that needs this message. There's somebody here today that you brought me here with a divine appointment to preach this message. And I pray today that your Holy Spirit could take it and drive it deep into a heart. I ask today that I could be your man and preach without apology and preach it straight. Dear God, we give you the next few moments. You take it. You bless it. Whatever you do, however you do it, we're going to thank you and give you all the praise and the honor and every bit of the glory. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, and you may be seated. This morning we see Jesus as he takes a paintbrush. Did you see it? He took a paintbrush and he painted us a portrait of a fool. A fool. I don't know about you. I'm not in the habit of calling people fool. You ever met somebody that they, you know, "You fool"? You know, the Bible says call no man a fool. But I got to believe that if God called this man a fool, he really was a fool. Won't you imagine? God called him a fool. Now, I know many times in my life, and I'm sure you'd agree with me, there's times when you meet people and you're pretty sure you just met a fool. You know, have you ever just met someone and you walked away going, "You know, I just met a fool." I fly all the time, and if you go to the airport much, you go down to that counter and put them bags up on that Delta Airlines scale, and they push 1,000 buttons, and every once in a while, one of those employees will look up at you and go, "Mr. York, has anybody put anything in your luggage without your knowledge?" Well, you know, if it was without my knowledge, how would I know? Are you a fool? I went to the department store the other day and I bought something and handed the girl my credit card, and she gave me that slip and I signed it, and all of a sudden she flipped my card over and she said, "Sir, I cannot accept your credit card." I said, "Why not?" She said, "You didn't sign it on the back." I said, "Give it here." She gave it to me. I signed it. I gave it back to her. You know what she did? She compared the signatures. "I just signed them both in front of you. Of course they match. Are you a fool? Some days you just find them a fool today." And then, Brother Lamb, I know there's days when you feel like a fool. Brother Lamb knows this story well because it happened this week. We went to a preacher's meeting up in Canton, Ohio. They had a nice breakfast at the Hampton. Now, they don't do the breakfast like they usually do because of the COVID. Everything's behind a table and a lady. It's in a refrigerator, and you got to put it in the microwave. Everything's cold. And they had two hard-boiled eggs in a plastic bag, refrigerated. They were pre-peeled, and they were cold. And I know, don't put a cold egg in a microwave oven. They will blow up. I know that. I'm not a fool. So I sliced them in two, put a little salt and pepper, and when I went over to the microwave, there was a toaster on top, and there was a little squirt bottle that just looked like I figured they'd put liquid butter. It's a butter dispenser. And those eggs looked awful dry, and I thought they would be good with a little butter on them, and so I took the dispenser, and I squirted butter on my halves of my hard-boiled eggs, microwaved them, went over to eat them, and these eggs are mad. And my son came and sat there going, "Dad, I think that was hand sanitizer you squirted on those." You know, President Trump said, "Drink disinfectant." I am disinfected now. But I felt like a fool. We meet fools. We feel like fools. But today, guess what? We get to meet a bona fide fool. Jesus tells us about the fool. And let's learn today about the fool. First off, I want you to notice, this man was a fool about his person. Did you notice that in the verse, there's no mention of any family? There's no mention of any neighbors? There's no mention of any friends? It's all about him. In fact, in three verses, he refers to himself either with a noun or a pronoun 11 different times. Did you see it? "My crops, my barns, I will do it." Went on and it all went on. This is a man who worshiped at the altar of himself. Have you ever seen a person that can strut sitting down? Here he is. Everything in life was about him. And let me say something to you. You're important to God. But you're not the creator. You're the creature. Do you understand that? And there's some of you this morning, even as I'm speaking right now, you can barely concentrate on what I'm preaching about because you're already worried about what you're going to eat for lunch. You're already wondering who's going to play football this afternoon. Some of you have already gone to work tomorrow and you are wondering what you're going to do at your job. You know why? Because in your life, everything is all about That's the reason we've got people that come to church regularly, and these chairs are too soft. And they're too hard. And Brother Matt, you've got the air turned up too high. And the sound was too strong. And I didn't like that song. And I don't like this little fat evangelist. He's kind of mousy. And look at that hair. He could put a second face up there. Do you realize life is not all about you? This man, it was all about him. Paul wrote to the church in Rome there, in Romans 12:3. He said, "For I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God had dealt to every man the measure of faith." You know what that verse means? Don't esteem yourself over much. Don't be arrogant. Williams translated that verse and said, "Don't estimate yourself above your real value." Wow. You know what, folks? This man was a fool about his person because everything was about him. When I was a student at Baptist Bible College years ago, Brother Matt, they wouldn't allow us to have televisions because they thought we should just pray and meditate all the time. But it was the final game of the NBA playoffs. It was the LA Lakers against the Boston Celtics. We had to see that game, Brother Lang. We had to see it. So we went out and found a 13-inch television set. We put it in a cardboard box. And we carried it into the dorm, knowing that if we got caught, they'd kick us out. Or at least hurt us bad. And we carried it into the dorm, put it in the closet, cut it flat. We're down on the first floor of Berea Annex that night. The game was in L.A., so it was late at night. And we're down there watching the Boston Celtics play the L.A. Lakers. It got down to the last 5 seconds of the game, and the Boston Celtics were ahead by 1 point. The Lakers would get the ball, and they would inbound it. Everybody in the world knew who they would inbound the ball to. There was no doubt who they would inbound the game. The ball would go into the greatest L.A. Laker player that ever lived. You remember who it was? Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. Now, for you kids, that's not a football player. That's a basketball player. His name was Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. And they inbounded the ball to Kareem. He dribbled just one or two steps. He flipped that ball in the air. It arched in the air. And at the top of the arch, the buzzer went, "Nyeh!" It was silent in the arena. It was silent in our dorm room. And that ball fell. Swish, all net right through the middle. Ah! We're jumping up and down on the bed. We're screaming. And the door opens. Oh. And it's our floor mom. He goes, "You guys got a TV in here. You're in big trouble." He closed the door. He said, "Right after the post-game show." He sat down in the bed with us. People are running all over that basketball court, screaming and yelling. And a reporter ran out there with a camera and a microphone. And they ran up to Kareem and stuck the mic in his face and said, "Kareem, you've just made one of the greatest shots in the history of the NBA. What do you have to say?" And I've thought since then many times what he could have said. He could have said, "I'd like to thank God for making me 7 foot tall, because that really helped. I'd like to thank my mom and dad for raising me. I'd like to thank my coaches in junior high, high school, college, and professional. I'd like to thank my teammates because they blocked everybody out so I could make that shot." But I'll never forget, Kareem looked right into that camera and said, "What can I say?" It was just like he was saying, you know, "I'm the greatest." And I thought, Kareem, you were standing on the shoulders of thousands of people that got you to that place in your career. And at the moment of truth, you took all the credit.
Yeah. Amen.
And And I want to tell you this morning that some of you need to realize that you are standing on the shoulders of thousands of people that got you to where you are right now in your life. It's not all about you. Have you ever driven down one of these old country roads back here and seen a turtle sitting on top of a fence post? I guarantee you he didn't get there by himself. And I'm going to tell you, you didn't get where you are in life by yourself. Don't be a fool about your person. And then secondly, I want you to notice, this man was a fool about his possessions. And you need to realize next, understanding who you are is understanding what you have. His crops were so abundant, he had to build bigger barns. He was a fool about what he had. You see, today, there really is only three philosophies of possessions. Three. First, it's what I would call the perverted philosophy. You know what the perverted philosophy of possessions is? It's this. I want your money, and I'm going to do whatever it takes to get it. Yeah. That's the philosophy of the criminal. That's why he breaks into your house and steals your stuff. That is the philosophy of the crooked politician. They want our money. That is the philosophy of the pornographer. One of the leading pornographers in America was interviewed the other day, and they asked him, does it bother you at all that pornography is hurting people? That it desensitizes young men about women? It degrades women? It destroys marriages? Does that bother you at all? And you know what one of the leading pornographers said? Pornography puts a roof over my family and food on their table. You see, he didn't care how he got your money. He didn't care the damage it does. He just wants your money. And that is a perverted philosophy of possessions. Then there's what I would call the second philosophy, which would be what I like to call the... Now, the first one was, I wanted to call it pagan. This one's perverted. Excuse me, I got ahead of myself. The first philosophy is a pagan. The second one is a perverted. And I hate to say it, that's the most widely held philosophy in this room this morning. It's not, I'm going to get what is yours. It's a philosophy of, what I get, I'm going to keep. Boy, do we ever have this philosophy today. I'm going to get all I can, and I'm going to can all I get. It's mine, it's mine, it's mine. I earned it. I worked for it. It's my money. I'm not going to share it with anybody. I'm going to keep it. And I'm going to tell you, that is an improper philosophy of possessions. And that's why we got people, even in our churches, that are tight and stingy. Brother Lamb, I hate to say it, but you've got a few folks here today. They got up this morning. They screwed their britches on with a screwdriver. You know what? Because they're going to hold on to what they got. It's all theirs. It's mine. I work for it. I earned it. It's my money. It's my stuff. And I'm going to tell you, that is not a proper philosophy. And that should not be the philosophy of born again Christians. And then we've got what I call the proper philosophy. What is a right philosophy of possessions? It's very simple. Everything I've got belongs to God. That's it. Period. Everything I've got belongs to God. I came into this world naked. I'll go out naked. Everything he's given me, it's because of him. It is a proper philosophy. I had an evangelist friend, and he met a pastor one day that told him that they had family in their church. And the family had a job, but they couldn't get to work because they didn't have a car. It was kind of a catch-22. They got to have a car to get to work. So the pastor got up before the church and he said, hey folks, we need to start praying for this family. They don't have a car. They need a car. Let's pray that God will give them a car. And the preacher said, I didn't know that God wanted them to have my car. And the preacher had almost a brand new car. And he gave that car to that family in the church. And my evangelist friend, he asked the preacher, which I think was a good question, preacher, how do you give away a brand new car? And you know what he said? He said, it only hurts if you love it. You know what? If you've fallen in love with your possessions, it's hard to be generous. It's hard to be a giver. It's hard to realize that everything I've got belongs to God. Now, don't go out here today and say, Brother Kent's a communist. I'm not. I'm a capitalist through and through. But I believe in helping people, and I believe in giving, but I don't believe in the government telling me how I got to do it.
Amen.
Christians ought to be able to do it themselves with a heart of love and examine every situation. You see, this man was a fool about what he had. He didn't think about anybody else that might have been had a bad year. He didn't think about had a neighbor that their crop got destroyed. No, it was all his, and he was going to hold on to it. And then thirdly, I want you to notice this man was a fool about his pleasures. Go to that weird verse. I call verse 19 the weird verse because it's weird when a man talks to his soul. And I will say to my soul, and he calls him by name, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. Now notice the last part of that verse. He uses the phrase, I'm going to eat, I'm going to drink, and I'm going to make merriment. That's what it means. I don't know about you, but that kind of sums up what the world today says is having a good time. First, he says, I'm going to eat. Isn't food a good friend? Isn't food soothing? There's a couple of you right now going, yeah, if you'd shut up, we go eat right now. Food comforts the body. You ladies, listen to me, ladies. Any of you ladies ever get a little depressed and discouraged? And you go by that Speedway station, and you know they got a little food mart in there. And a really good friend lives in that food mart. You know who he is? Uh-huh. Mr. Ho-Ho. And you ever notice those ho-hos never come in a single pack? It's always a double ho-ho. There's always two ho-hos. And you walk up and lay those two ho-hos on the counter, and the guy that's checking you out, he kind of looks at you like, you're really going to eat those? And you're like, my kids really like those in their sack lunch. I would dream of ever eating a ho-ho. Then you get out in your car. You pull over to the corner of the parking lot, put up your tinted windows. Oh, there's your ho-ho, I missed you. Now, why are some of you looking at me like I'm the only one that ever did that? That's really hurtful. I'm talking about women. Food is just a good friend. He says, I'm going to eat. And then I'm going to drink. Now, this doesn't mean he's going to get a big old glass of ice water. He's not thirsty. The word drink here actually means that he's going to drink something that is intoxicating. He's going to try and medicate himself. He's going to try and change his mind. In fact, people who drink alcoholic beverages, that's why they drink them, not because they're delicious. Most of them taste like battery acid. They drink because they're trying to change their mind. I spent my whole ministry working with AA and RU and all these other alcoholic ministries. And you know what? Everybody I meet in these ministries, they are trying to do one thing, and that is they're trying to drown their problems. And I got news for you. Your problems know how to swim. It don't work. You kids over here, you listen to me. You young people, so don't listen to me. God don't make you wiser. Makes you stupider. He says, I'm going to eat, and then I'm going to drink something that's going to change my mind. And then he says, I'm going to make merry or make merriment. And when you study that word in the original language in its root form, it has a sexual context. I'm going to satisfy my sexual desires. I'm going to make merriment. Does this kind of sound like what the world today calls party and hearty?
Yep, party.
I'm going to get me some chicken wings and some pizza. I'm going to get me a couple of six-packs, and then I'm going to get my girlfriend, my boyfriend, we're going to party hard. And that's exactly what the world calls having a good time today. Going for all the gusto. Have you ever tried to travel and read travel books about what places you're going, and all they want to talk about is how many bars and how many places, and I'm like, we don't care about any of that. But the world does, because that's what the world calls having a good time, and God called him a fool. And I'll tell you right now that if this is how you derive your greatest joy in life, then you're as big a fool as he is. Now, I know I'm talking to a bunch of Baptists here at the church. Some of you are eating anybody yet. I don't drink, I don't smoke, I don't dip, I don't go with girls that do. But you know what? Where do you derive your greatest amount of joy? I'm going to get personal here, preacher. Hold on. Is it playing golf? Is it hunting? Fishing? Garage selling? Making crafts. What is it? If you derive your greatest joy in life with something other than serving God, reading His Word, and talking to Him, you're as big a fool as this man was. He was a fool about his pleasures. And then lastly, and I'll quit. This man was a fool about his predictions. Go back to that verse 19 again. And I will say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. You see, he thought he was going to enjoy all this for a long time, and the truth be told, he would not see the sun come up the next morning. He was going to die that night. It amazes me how that people are dying every day. But when you talk to people, nobody's dying tomorrow. I can go over here and find one of these teenage boys and say, how old are you, son? Are you 16 years old? Well, I tell you what, how old are you going to live? Well, I'm going to live to be 116 at least. With modern medicine, you might. Then I go back here and find me a little old lady. And she's 86 years old. Honey, how long are you going to live? Well, I'm still kicking. Isn't that amazing? Young people are not dying tomorrow. Old people are not dying tomorrow. But you mark it down, somebody's dying tomorrow. And it could be any of us. But this man said he was going to live for many years. I'm going to build these big old barns. I'm going to eat, drink, and make merriment, and I'm going to do it for a long time. And his life would be over tonight. He was a fool about his predictions. The Bible says life is but a vapor. It's here and it's gone. You have no guarantee of tomorrow. Oh, we got plans. You already got plans this week. But you know what? We have no guarantee of that. My son Ben, he pastors a church up in Hilliard in the Columbus area. Years ago, Brother Lamb, he was our youth pastor at our church in Oklahoma. Ben used to like to take the teens out on Monday night and they'd go door knocking because he thought it was good for the teens to go out and knock doors, and they did it. One Monday night, they got up on a porch. Ben said the boy was a head taller than him. He leaned into that screen door and talked to my son. His name was Cody. And Ben asked him very quickly, Cody, do you know if you died today, you'd go to heaven? And Cody didn't know. And he said, no, I'm not saved. And Ben said, well, let me tell you how you trust Christ right now. And Ben told me, he said, Dad, that boy was brutally honest. He leaned into that screen door and said, sir, I'm 17 years old. I'm a senior in high school. I'm going to start on the football team this Friday night. I've got my friends and my schoolwork. I don't have time for you. And Ben said, well, Cody, I know you're busy. But if you just give me a minute, I can tell you how you could know tonight. If you died, you'd go to heaven. And the boy said, I'm not coming to your church, and if I ever did go to church, I would go to my mother's church someday. Ben couldn't convince the kid to listen. They walked off that porch at about 6:20 that night. Left him at the door. Cody was a senior at our high school. He was starting on the football game Friday night. They were having two-a-day practices at the high school, and on Wednesday, he felt sick when he went to practice in the morning, but he made it to school. And then he went to the afternoon second practice. And during the second practice, Cody collapsed on the practice field. He didn't lose consciousness, but our coach was concerned enough that he called an ambulance. They took him to our little regional hospital. He had a high white blood count. He was running a fever. He was very nauseated. They didn't know what was the matter with him. So they called his mother, who was a beauty operator, and she shut her chair down. She rode in the ambulance as they transferred him to Children's Hospital in Oklahoma City. Friday night, Cody didn't get to start the football game because he was still in the hospital. In fact, he stayed in the hospital all weekend. And to everybody's amazement, every day he was in the hospital, he didn't get better. He got worse every day. And Wednesday at 4:30, Cody died. 17 years old. A big, striking football player. You see, when he stood on the porch with my son Ben, that boy didn't have 10 days to live. But he thought he had his whole life. Cody was a fool. And to our knowledge, he never did get saved. I really believe God sent my boy in there to give him one last chance. And he was a fool. And I'm going to tell you this morning, maybe very much, that God sent me here today to give you one last chance. God might have brought me here today to preach this message to ring your bell and say, listen to that preacher. Because you don't have the rest of this life to live. You may only have a day or two. This may be the last message you'll ever hear. Don't be a fool about your predictions. This man was a fool. And what did Jesus say? so is he that layeth up treasures for himself on this earth. But he's not rich toward God. Let me ask you this morning. Are you wise? Or are you living your life like this? It'd be a great morning to come to this altar. We've got men that are trained. We've got ladies that are trained. They're not going to embarrass you, but they're going to pray with you. And they're going to show you how you can call upon the name of Jesus today.
Yeah.
And you can walk out that door wise that I know where I'm going to spend eternity. And it's not based upon my things. It's based upon Jesus Christ. Don't be a fool. Would you stand with me?